Understanding Our Mind Better, Part 1, Professor Vishala Patnam, Human Development Expert.
Hello, I am retired professor and human development scientist, Vishala Patnam. Who am I and what am I? Who am I is easy to get the answer. If you ask me who am I would say, I am retired professor Vishala Patnam. If you ask me, what am I? It is a very laborious process. It's not so easy to understand what am I. Because what am I as a Vishala depends on my thinking process, my attitudes, my values. How do I respond to my environment? How do I react to my environment or the stimuli around me? And how do I think about it? How do I perceive things? All these matter. Actually, it requires a lot of daring to know what am I. It is more than participating in a nuclear war. Why? Because our mind influences all our actions, attitudes, thinking process, all that. This mind has a lot of energy. In a nutshell, I am, this Vishala is bundle of psychic energy. I'll be taking the base of psychoanalytic theory of Sigmund Freud, but I'll be adapting to my own experiences and what are the little research I have done in this area. Last 40 years, when I was dealing with hundreds of students, colleagues, my own life experiences at home and outside the home made me to develop a particular Vishala theory. This is very easy to understand our own self and to control our own self. So this psychic energy is comprised of three components: id, ego and superego. Suppose my psychic energy, when I was born, it might be 100% id, because this id works on pleasure principle. That is why babies right from birth, they demand so many things and they want immediate satisfaction of, immediate gratification of their needs. Gradually as they start growing, they understand that everything they demand cannot be fulfilled. Some have to be postponed. Some will never be given to them. So this process, we call it as socialization. That is why mind management does not come from just listening to me. It has to be through life experiences of the child right from day one. I say even before birth. Okay, now this id, as it gets transformed into ego and superego as the child starts growing older with its own experiences through the disciplinary practices, socialization practices adopted by family, by the preschools, the schools, colleges, everything, and the people around us. The ego is really, it works on reality principle. Always it makes us to get aware about our own mandatory responsibilities, mandatory work, mandatory duties, all that. Ego generally develops in childhood. Then by the end of the early childhood, superego also develops. Superego functions on moral principle. It means it is dharma. It is conscience. Always it wants to do the things in the arbitrary of moral values. That is why whenever we do good things in a day or in an hour, we feel so happy. Not that somebody has noticed our good work, good deeds, appreciated us, but it is for the self-satisfaction. So superego makes us, we don't work, we don't do things for others' sake, it is for our own happiness, it is for our own satisfaction. In the world, there was a report, 10 years back I read, 3 people had very high levels of superego, this conscience: Martin Luther, Mahatma Gandhi and Mother Teresa. Coincidentally, all of their M, it starts with M, Mahatma Gandhi, Mother Teresa, Martin Luther. So if we have to become a nice person, like in any religion, even religion also says we have to become a refined personality. To become that refined personality, we have to start converting the energy of id into ego and superego. Automatically we get self-discipline and we have strong conscience. Even all the great gurus in any religion, they talk about if you have to become a good person, you have to increase your conscience. You don't require anybody to control you. The psychic energy total, if we consider it as 100%, in newborn state, infancy, toddler, the id will be more. That is why children are very stubborn. They want things to be done, because even the family also is very considerate. We understand that when they are children, we have to fulfill their, what are the demands they have, we have to fulfill it. But gradually we have to teach children to postpone certain desires which can be postponed for some time. Suppose if morning the child demands for something, you can say evening will do it better, not now. So gradually making them to postpone certain desires which can be postponed and certain desires to give up which cannot be possible to provide by the family. To understand our mind, it is very easy. I make it very simple, even though it is scientific. Our mind has the characteristics of, main characteristics. There are so many characteristics of all elements. Mainly, I consider it is like a air in the gas form, and water and fire. Let us take air. Air can be easily condensed, and if we don't condense it, air can occupy any space indefinitely it occupies. So our emotions, our mind, if it is positive, we can do wonders in life. If we think negative thoughts can make us get into depression, get into even suicides, or you can even murder in that emotion. So the dangerous things, it can expand indefinitely our mind. So it is very important to understand this characteristic. When it is at expanding stage or condensing stage, you should know how much to expand and how much to condense based on the circumstances. Same way water. Water is universal solvent. Many material which are added to the water, water takes its characteristic. For example, if I add bitter substance to the water, water takes, it dissolves that bitter substance and water's taste becomes bitter. Suppose if I add sugar to the water or honey, immediately it becomes sweeter. So in our life, what are we adding to the mind? Are we filtering and putting some filters not to take in? Same way when we are expressing our emotions also, we can put the filters not to allow everything to come out. Okay, water is transparent. we are also, most of our emotions are transparent. In general, our emotions are revealed very easily because our emotions are seen on our face, in our actions, in our behavior. Emotions are more revealed on the face and in our behavior. That is why we call it as face is index of mind. Face is index of mind. If we are upset, immediately it is seen. That is why parents, teachers do mostly face reading of the concerned students and children to understand them better. Next one is fire. Fire, you can destroy within seconds. You can make marvelous and beautiful things. For cooking, without fire we cannot. With fire, application of fire, we can make that wheat flour into very tasty, delicious, beautiful chapatis. Anything you can make with the fire. Fabrication. So many hard things can be melted in welding process. You see, when you sit with the welder, it is so fascinating. I love that job to see that. So, fabrication, welding it. In a welder, he can join it, he can break things. He can cut them through the welding machine. So this, our mind can make us, it can destroy us, it can make us weld, join things and make our life beautiful. So mind is just like water, just like air, just like fire. How do we use it? It depends on our socialization process and on our own management, mind management. Mind is so precious. Please continue to listen to the second part, because I'll be dealing with these energies, 8 ego and superego. How do they interact? And because of their interaction, because of their influences on each other, how we behave, how we think, how we act, and what kind of personality we develop. Don't forget to listen to the part 2, and don't forget to share it and to like it, please.